secure, and peaceful future. I hope that you will all join us every Tuesday at 2 p.m. Eastern Time for our regularly scheduled weekly webinars. Next Tuesday, April 21st, we will speak with Dr. Shira Efron and Evan Gottesman, the authors of Israel Policy Forum's groundbreaking new study, In Search of a Viable Option, evaluating 7 potential outcomes to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. Today, we are so pleased to be joined by a very good friend of Israel Policy Forum, Colonel Shaul Arieli, who will explain the Trump plan, its feasibility, implications, and why many Israeli leaders are still seeking to implement its annexation provisions. Shaul is one of the foremost experts on the Israeli-Palestinian conflict and is a policy advisor to Israel Policy Forum. Shaul previously served as commander of an IDF brigade in the Gaza Strip, as head of the Interim Agreement Administration in the Rabin government, and as head of the Peace Administration in the Barak government. As always, we welcome your questions in today's discussion. If you are joining us via the Zoom link, you can click on Q&A to type out your questions. If you're joining by phone, please email your questions to info@ipforum.org. We will try to get to as many of your questions as possible during the time we have today. In discussing the Trump plan and annexation, we also can't ignore the political drama unfolding in Israel as we speak. Last night, Benny Gantz's mandate to form a government expired. And in an unprecedented move over the weekend, President Reuven Rivlin refused to extend it. But after a joint request from both Gantz and Prime Minister Netanyahu, Rivlin conceded granting an extension until Wednesday, tomorrow. What happens next will either finally break Israel's political deadlock or extend it even further. So before we get into our main program today, Israel Policy Forum's Policy Director, Michael Koplow, will give us a brief update on what's happening in Jerusalem. Michael?
Thanks, Susie. This will indeed be very brief since I don't want to take any time away from Shaul. So as Susie noted, Benny Gantz had asked for a 14-day extension to his mandate, which officially expired at midnight yesterday. For the first time in Israel's history, the president refused to grant that extension, largely because Prime Minister Netanyahu told Rivlin that the two sides were not close. And so Rivlin announced that there was no reason to extend Gantz's mandate and that he was also not going to assign the mandate to Prime Minister Netanyahu when Gantz's mandate expired. Yesterday, right before the midnight deadline, Prime Minister Netanyahu apparently told President Rivlin that the two sides were closer. And so he gave him an extra 48 hours to try and strike a deal. That expires tomorrow night at midnight. And Gantz and Netanyahu have broken off their talks today, but their negotiating teams are going to pick it back up tomorrow when Chag is over in Israel, in order to see if they can conclude a deal by midnight. Now, if a deal is concluded, then the two will form a unity government, and we'll have to wait and see what the precise parameters of that will be, but presumably it will involve some sort of rotation between Netanyahu and Gantz. And as a reminder, they've been talking about 18 months with Netanyahu as prime minister, and then things moving over. If those talks are not successful by tomorrow night at midnight, then President Rivlin has 3 days to decide what to do. He has indicated that he will return the mandate to the Knesset. If that happens, there will be 21 days for any Knesset member to try and receive 61 recommendations to form a government. If a Knesset member is able to receive 61 or more recommendations, he or she will have 14 days to form a government. And if none of that is successful, then Israel at that point will be heading to its fourth election. When that will happen, nobody will know, because obviously coronavirus complicates things. And it's an open question as to whether voting in person can be held, and if not, how you structure an election, and if so, how long you have to wait. So we should know more in 3 or 4 weeks, assuming that there is no agreement by tomorrow, but that is where things stand at the moment.
Thank you, Michael. Now I'd like to turn it over to Shaul for his presentation. Shaul, vakasha.
Okay, I'm ready.
Okay.
Okay. So, Chag Sameach again. I'm glad to see so many participants in this lecture. Hope everyone is healthy and we will enjoy this event. I would like to start by saying that it's very important to know and to understand the narrative of both parties, because the narrative is the one that defines their policies and attitudes towards the Trump initiative. For the Palestinian, I will start with the Palestinians, of course. For the Palestinians, the opening shoot of the conflict is the Balfour Declaration that came out in November 1917, and also the League of Nations decision to give the mandate of Palestine to establish the Jewish national home, despite the fact that the Arabs were the majority in the population, almost 90% of the population. This decision of the League of Nations created the discourse of the Palestinians about the conflict and also defined the Palestinian policy, which lays on three main pillars. The first one, no Zionist immigration to Palestine, not selling land to Jews. These are very important things, because this way were the way to for the Jewish and Zionist movement to change the demographic balance between Jews and Arabs in the land of Palestine, and also to achieve a special dominance. And the last pillar of the Palestinian policy was, of course, their demands for independent Palestinian state. But this policy contradicts the international community position and resolution, and led the Palestinians to the Nakba, the lack of citizenship, the lack of a state. And the change took place in 1988. The Palestinian discourse moved to new discourse that lays on in the international community resolution, especially 242, which means that they are going to establish their independent states only on 22% of the historical Palestine. This happened because of the changing that we had faced during this year in 1988, you know, like the collapse of the Soviet Union, also the first Intifada, the appearance of the Hamas movement as a national opposition to the PLO, and also even the appearance of a new leadership, local leadership in the West Bank, like Faisal Husseini and like Seri Nusseibeh. All of this led the Palestinians to recognize the partition plan, 181 United Nations resolution, and of course, 242 United Nations Security Council resolution. What happened on the other side, on the Israeli side? As you know, the Zionist movement always has the same three strategic goals: to be democratic state with Jewish majority on the entire land of Israel. But because of the demographic balance with the Arab majority, the Zionist movement has to decide about the priority, about the implementation of those three strategic goals. And I can tell you that over the last century, it was always the same priority: to be a democratic state with Jewish majority and to give up on part of the land of Israel. So we can see, for instance, here in 1947, how David Ben-Gurion decided to send this letter to the Minister of Foreign Affairs, the British Minister of Foreign Affairs, Bevin, and to say that the only possible solution for the conflict in Palestine is to establish two states, one Jewish and one Arabs. And it was the same decision, the same policy of the Zionist movement after the 48 war, when we signed the armistice agreement with four Arab countries. And despite the fact that the IDF can occupy the entire territory between the Jordan River and the sea, David Ben-Gurion decided to give up on part of the land of Israel for Jewish state, as you can see here in the trade-off between a wall land and the Jewish state, we have chosen the Jewish state. So after the Six-Day War in 1967, tension remained. Israel did not annex the territories except East Jerusalem because of the same priorities. The demographic balance, the First Intifada, and the threat from the Iran pushed Rabin into the Oslo agreement. So to conclude this part, we can say that the PLO came to Oslo to get its rights of 22% of the historical Palestine, according to their interpretation of Resolution 242. And Israel came up with a different approach. Why? Because the tension that the Israeli government headed by Rabin had faced in those days was between the implementation of 242 and three main interests that Israel had beyond the 67 borders. First of all, security, because of the unstable situation around Israel. Second, the holy places, especially in Jerusalem, you know, the Temple Mount and the Western Wall, and also the Jewish settlement. And I'm talking about 100,000 of Israelis who are living beyond the 67 borders. And of course, regarding to the Palestinian refugee issue, is the saving the Jewish majority. And our challenge during this negotiation was to find the creative solution, how to reduce this tension and how to find a solution to bridge this gap. But Israel interpreted 242 withdrawal from the territories and not from all the territories. And despite the precedent that we had with the peace treaty with Jordan and with Egypt. So Israel demands to fulfill those three main interests by annexation of part of the West Bank without giving the Palestinian the right compensation. We can see here in this map what was the Israeli proposal in Camp David summit that took place in 2000. Israel annexed Ehud Barak, the prime minister, asked to annex 11% of the West Bank. And also, this is the blue area that you see at this map. And also to keep for 20 years the green area, which was about 8%. Means the answer, the Israeli answer for the Palestinian demands was not for 22% of the historic Palestine. It was the same in Taba summit that took place in January 2001 after President Clinton came out with his parameter in December 2000. And on the left side of this slide, you can see the Israeli proposal, still between 6 to 8% annexation to Israel, the blue area, but still without compensation to the Palestinians, means not for 22%. On the right side of this slide, you can see the Palestinian proposal that fit Clinton parameters about annexation of 3% to Israel. So, but because of the Second Intifada, as you know, Camp David summit and Taba summit failed, and we faced the terror during the Second Intifada, and Israel, headed by Ariel Sharon, decided to build the separation or the security barrier. And the idea was to to create de facto, not de jure, the border between Israel and Palestine by annexing part of the West Bank. It started with 17% of the West Bank, and in the end of this process, it reached only to 8%, all the area between the red line that we can see here, the root of the separation barrier, and the green line. The Israeli prime minister who did the leap of faith was, of course, Ehud Olmert in 2007-2008 during Annapolis process. And you can read here that he understood that we cannot achieve all the three strategic goals of the Zionist movement, the land of Israel, Jewish character, and democratic state. So he said, but when it is impossible, responsible leadership must recognize it and come to terms it, draw the necessary conclusion. And this is exactly what he did together with Mahmoud Abbas in 2008. And they agreed on the four main parameters for the final status settlements. For the borders, it was 67 borders as a basis with a land swap on one-to-one ratio, security, demilitarization of the Palestinian state, Jerusalem, the division of East Jerusalem into two capitals, and refugee, the solution to the refugee problem, not by returning to Israel, by returning to the state of Palestine, and of course, compensation. Here we can see what were the Palestinian and the Israeli proposal for the territorial issue in Annapolis 2008. On the left side, again, the Palestinian proposal, which talk about a land swap of less than 2%, but it was yes for 22%, the main position of the Palestinian movement of the PLO. And also on the right side, we see the Israeli proposal, which talk about land swap of 6.5%, but still according to the same parameter of 22% of the historical Palestine for the Palestinian. Also, for Jerusalem, we can see on the left side the Israeli position. To divide East Jerusalem according to Clinton parameter means according to the demographic parameter. And here on the left side, you can see the Israel can annex all the Israeli neighborhoods, the blue color here to Israel. But Israel also asked to annex this small Palestinian neighborhood, Beit Safafa. And on the right side, we have the same proposal from the Palestinian side, from Mahmoud Abbas. They asked to annex all the Palestinian, all neighborhoods, all the green area, but also Har Choma neighborhood, because we built Har Choma after we signed the DOP, the Declaration of Principle, Oslo I in 1993. And also, it was the same apply for the historic or the Holy Basin in Jerusalem, or to divide it, or to share the responsibility and the sovereignty on this area. For the security challenge, we have a full set of security arrangement, especially the demilitarization of the Palestinian state and many other things that I think that we don't need to pass on it. And for the refugee issue, we have here eight elements of components for the solution, and of claim citizenship for the Palestinians, of course, in the Palestinian state, and many other things. So this process was summarized by Ehud Olmert when he said, "I was a touch away from a peace agreement. The Palestinians never rejected my proposals, and the gaps were very small, as we already saw." So what about Trump plan, or the name is, of course, the, the peace vision of Trump or Trump vision for peace. Here I can say that like many other things, here too Netanyahu and Trump are using the usual concept in the peace process by applying them in a completely contradictory way. They are using the concept that we know, two-state and the West Bank Gaza corridor, Palestinian capital in East Jerusalem, territorial contiguity, land swap, and many other things. But if we look to this proposal more carefully and we drill down to the details, we can see, for instance, about the land swap. About the land swap is not on one-to-one ratio. It's 1:2.13 ratio, means that Israel will annex 1,775 square kilometers and the Palestinians only 833 square kilometers, means not for 22% for the Palestinian state. You can see all the blue area will annex to Israel, all the green areas will annex to Palestine. Here, about the Palestinian contiguity, the Palestinian state will include five isolated areas from the north, like Jenin area with Nablus, Ramallah, Hebron with Bethlehem, Gaza Strip, and the two new area for the Palestinian state. Nine new interchange out of 15 that were proposed by this vision. And also to build something between 200 to 400 new roads for the Palestinian contiguity. As you can see here at this slide, they should build all the orange roads that we can see here at this map, means not for Palestinian contiguity. Also, the length of the border, just to compare it to the current situation, that the green line, it's less than 400 kilometers. The proposed boundary in this vision, it's almost 1,700 kilometers. And we also need to add this part in the Jordan Valley. This is the border today between the West Bank and Jordan. And according to this vision, it will be under the Israeli control. So, and just to compare it to the rest of the Israeli borders, the length is about 600 kilometers. It means that Israel has to invest all the IDF to protect those borders, means not for the Israelis' security. Here at this map, we can see the 43 Palestinian enclaves, 43 Palestinian villages that will be inside the Israeli area. You see here all the numbers with more than 100,000 residents, but also we should add, according to this vision, also the Israeli Arab towns inside Israel, the green dots that we can see here, that according to this vision, they will be part of Palestine as an enclave. So it's also to say no for the fabric of life of the Palestinian by adopting such a very strange map. The same as we can see here, because of the decision not to evacuate even one single settlement from the West Bank, it means that Israel will have almost 17 enclaves in the Palestinian state with 16,000 residents. And also to the IDF will protect almost 135 kilometers of protected roads, what you can see here, the blue line between the Israeli area and the Israeli enclaves here in the Palestinian state means not for the Palestinian contiguity again. Here I can give you such an example about the lack of professionalism and familiarity with the area, because according to the vision, this area will be part of Palestine near from Gaza Strip along the border with Egypt. But look what happened with almost 10 Israeli villages here between the Palestinian area and the Egyptian border. There will be also Israeli enclave near the Palestinian state. And what about Jerusalem? Here we see what is today United Jerusalem. And according to this vision, almost all the area of Jerusalem, means 93% of United Jerusalem, will stay as the Jewish or the Israeli capital. And only those two part of this city, one of them is a refugee camp, Shafat refugee camp, and also this area that was not part of Jerusalem until 67, Israel decided to annex it only after 67 war. There will be, as you can see here, there will be, according to this vision, the Palestinian capital in Jerusalem together with Abu Dis, this small town near Jerusalem. It means, again, not for Palestinian capital in Jerusalem. So if we want to summarize this vision and to compare it to Annapolis process, so we already talk about the borders and the Jerusalem. So about security, in Annapolis, it was only demilitarization of the Palestinian state. Here we are talking about this able state without external border, and Israel has the overriding responsibility for the security of the Palestinian state. Also about refugees, here we are talking about return to the Palestinian state, and here Israel also has the veto to prevent from the Palestinian refugee to return even to the Palestinian state. What about the responses to this vision? About the Arab world that was part of Annapolis process, support and participate in this process, here in this, for this vision, we are talking about refusing or silence of the Arab world. The Palestinians were full partners of Annapolis process. Here they are out of the game. And also about the international community that was part of Annapolis process. Here there is nothing else than but Trump. And here we have one more factor about the Israeli Arabs that we always consider them as a citizen of the state. Here there are candidates for a transfer according to this vision. So the idea of the Annapolis and also process was about package deal. When Israel is taking in security, Israel must give back in the border issues. Also for the second couple of the issue, if Israel is asking the Palestinian to give up on the implementation of the right of return, Israel must give back to the Palestinian to establish their capital in East Jerusalem. What happened in the Trump vision? Israel is giving less and receiving more on any of these issues, as we already saw. So it means that this initiative brought the solution concept back 15 years back to the 1993, when the Israelis really thought that we can sign a peace agreement with the Palestinian and to reach to the end of conflict without giving back the entire West Bank and Gaza Strip. And for the Palestinians, is even return them back 100 years to their policy to establish only one state that will be Arab state between the Jordan River and the sea. Here, since Netanyahu re-election, the graph shows a steady decline of the support rates for the two-state solution, as we can see in this graph that was, this poll was done by the INSS in Israel. The graph is declining from 71% to 55%. Still, we have a majority of the Jewish society in Israel, which support the idea of two-state solution. But look, almost 74% of the Jewish society in Israel don't believe that this solution is achievable in the distant future or ever. This is because Israel avoid to include the terms of a two-state solution and peace in the public discourse in this last decade. And what we have today, what we have on the agenda? The agenda for the Netanyahu government, especially with, you know, all the right-wing parties, especially Yemina, but also the others, there is about annexation policy, as Netanyahu came out last year. We will apply Israeli sovereignty to all Jewish communities in the land of Israel. He referred, of course, to the settlements in the West Bank. Here we can see the most famous plan, which we call it the Jewish Home Plan, and the idea is to annex Area C. But as you can see, according to the short video that came out by this party, it seems like we are dealing with three perfect squares of Area A and B and C. Means that Area A and B, only those two areas will be under the Palestinian control, with most of the Palestinian population. In the Area C, 60% of the West Bank, it will be a part of Israel by annexing it to Israel. But the real situation and the real reality is totally different, as we can see at this map. We are not dealing with two perfect or three perfect squares. We are dealing with 169 isolated area, all the green areas that we can see here, with so many scores of corridors of Area C with the Israeli settlements. We are not talking about 300 kilometers of borders according to the Green Line. We are talking about 1,800 kilometers. It means that we have to dismantle the current or the existing separation barrier that we already invested 20 billion shekel to build it, and to build a new one, and to invest 30 billion shekel more. Just to remind you that more than half of Area C, it's private Palestinian land, belongs to 260 Palestinian villages. It means that we are going to harm this fabric of life of the Palestinians all over the West Bank, and many, many other things. It means that this idea, this plan, it's impossible to implement. So according to the CIS research that we made over the last 2 years, there are full applications about this unilateral step of annexation in the about security, about legal implications, about political implication, social and economical implication. And I don't have the time to present all of them, just to show these things from when Lieberman served as the Minister of Defense 3 years ago. He said to absorb 2.7 million Palestinians means that from day one, we will have to pay them $20 billion out of the national insurance. And this is only one small piece of the economy implication of this idea to annex Area C, and in the end of this process to annex all the West Bank, including Area B, A and B, with 3 million Palestinians who are living there today. It will be the end of the Zionist vision. It will be the change in the priority of the Zionist movement. Instead of a democratic state with Jewish majority, we will say apartheid. We will see apartheid state and to give up on the democratic pillars of the Zionist vision by this unilateral annexation of the West Bank. So to conclude, this presentation, and especially about Trump's vision, the plan is bad for Israel and not just for the Palestinians. The accepted harm is the consequence rather than its implementation, because we know that there is no partner for this plan from the Palestinian side or on the Arab world. But the implications are very severe, because this vision legitimizes the existing situation there, where two separate legal systems exist for the same residence. It means apartheid. This vision also damaging the PLO political strategy that could lead the return of the armed struggle, something that they give up on 1988 when they recognize 242. And also harming the security, or even to put the end of the security coordination with Israel, and also to put the end of or to harm the value of the citizenship. I'm talking about the Arab Israeli citizens, and also to harm the rule of the law and property right because of their intention, or their because they want to legalize the illegal outpost. And I'm talking about those small Israeli settlements that were built on private Palestinian land. And of course, this vision also will create immigration for the Palestinian to Jerusalem within the wall from the Palestinian neighborhood outside of the wall. So it means that we need to give up on this idea, on this vision, and to readopt the idea of two-state solution according to the four parameters that Annapolis and Oslo process lay on them. Thank you.
Thank you, Shaul. That you gave us a lot to think about. That was terrific. Again, as a reminder to those who are on the call, if you want to ask a question, if you joined us via Zoom, please click on the Q&A link and type in your question. If you're joining by phone, please email your question to info@ipforum.org. Shaul, I'm going to kick it off with one or two questions, and we have some already in the queue. Okay. So as you know, Shaul, the Trump plan was released right before the onset of coronavirus, both in the United States and in Israel, as well as the rest of the world. And there was a bilateral US mapping committee that had been convened to demarcate West Bank annexation permitted under the plan. So now, of course, the focus in Israel and the United States around the world has shifted to this global pandemic. What does that mean in terms of the Trump plan and where things stand?
You know, this effect of Trump on the idea of two-state solution is very difficult to assess, because there are different phenomena with opposite direction to their effect. For example, medical cooperation, including with Gaza Strip, shows the real need for continued cooperation and dependencies of the both population. But on the other hand, we saw the irresponsible statement of the Palestinian leadership regarding Israel. They claim that Israel is infecting the Palestinians. Other phenomena is that Israelis understood the difficulty to control and to manage the lives of 5 million Palestinians without the PA. This is a red light for anyone thinking about the annexation. And maybe I can add one more thing. Despite the corona crisis, Netanyahu chose to put the focus on the annexation during his negotiation with Benny Gantz about the nomination of this government. Means that we don't know what will happen after we will finish the crisis of the coronavirus.
Okay, Shaul, we have some questions. So Dan Wander wants to know, if Israel does annex per the Trump plan, does this foreclose a two-state solution? If not, how many more steps in the annexation process would have to take place before the two-state solution would be foreclosed?
Again, I'm not sure that we have very clear answer to this question, because, but we know that when this vision came out, we familiar with the Palestinian response that for them, this will be the end of Oslo process and the end of the security and economic cooperation with Israel. We don't know what will be the first step of the Israeli government, if they are willing to annex in the first step the Jordan Valley, or maybe according to Ayelet Shaked proposal to annex the Jordan Valley together with the envelope of Jerusalem and even the rest of the Israeli settlements. So I think even the first step will be very crucial for the future of two-state solution, and the Israeli government must avoid to do even this first step because of the implications that I already described.
So Zach Freeman wants to know, is the unilateral withdrawal from Gaza seen as a historical mistake in Israel?
No, because no one is asking today to return to Gaza Strip, because it's better for the Israeli army to control Gaza Strip outside of Gaza Strip. We reduce the size of the forces around the Gaza Strip. I remember when I was a brigade commander in Gaza Strip, I had under my command almost 8 battalions. Today, the brigade commander has less than 3 battalions just to keep the same area. But I must admit that the way that we did it was a mistake. It should be as a part of the peace process with an agreement with the Palestinian Authority, with the PLO, and not as we did it as a unilateral step, something that strengthened the Hamas movement and helped the Hamas movement to win the election that took place in 2006. But we have to remember that Gaza Strip must be part of this solution. We cannot ask to have two separate Palestinian state, or maybe to push Gaza Strip to Egypt. We know exactly what is the Egyptian position about this idea. So we have to find the solution together for Gaza Strip and the West Bank as a part of peace agreement with the Palestinians.
Shaul, by the way, can you end your screen share so that we can see you? People want to see you better. If you want to just, can we click out of it? If it's possible. Yes. I don't know if it is. Okay, I'll keep going with questions. We got a lot of questions. There, yes, much better. Okay. Perfect. So Aaron Miller, hi Aaron, says, Shaul, terrific briefing. You've written in the past that a two-state solution acceptable to both sides is still possible. Do you still think so?
Yes, totally, because it's feasible. And I'm talking about the physical dimension or the spatial dimension. I always argue the same thing, that with 4% land swap between Israel and Palestine, Israel can keep 80% of the Israelis who are living beyond the 67 line without harming the Palestinian contiguity and the Palestinian fabric of life. Second, we can divide Jerusalem into two capitals, because this is the situation today. Of course, we have to create and to agree on special regime for the historic basin because of the only sites that we have there. About refugees, is the same solution that is already agreed in Annapolis process. We have to find the compromise between the Palestinian and the Israeli proposal, and it will be about 20, 30,000 Palestinians refugee will return to Israel. And of course, the security issue, which is very important for the Israeli public. And we know that we have a full set of security arrangements, how to protect Israel, and how even to upgrade the Israeli security by those arrangements like demilitarization of the Palestinian state, control the airspace, or to have early warning station in the Palestinian state, and many, many other security arrangements. And I really believe that we have this feasibility for two-state solution, but we also have the political dimension. And in this we have bad news, because as we know, the Israeli current government refused to accept those parameters to reach a peace agreement. And also we know about the split in the Palestinian side between the Hamas and the Fatah. And we know that we don't have really one single address with the Palestinians to negotiate. But still, I believe that the problem is with us, with the Israelis, because of the current government and its policy to annex part of the West Bank.
Shaul, Doug Sesserman wants to know, what is better, the Trump plan or no plan? He says, I'm assuming that there is no real promise for a mutually negotiated two-state peace agreement between the parties.
No plan, it's better than Trump plan. First of all, because no plan is keeping the current situation and is keeping the Oslo agreement with the existing of the Palestinian Authority, and also the security coordination and cooperation and the custom envelope for the economy issue. But of course, it's better to have a different plan based again on the same parameters that were used by the sides in Annapolis process in 2008, because there are part of the international community position. But for this, we need different plan. And I still believe that only the Americans has the power to propose this different plan, because only the Americans have the leverage on the Israeli government.
By the way, Shaul, a number of people are asking if you can share your presentation with the people on this call. So if you're okay with having it on the Israel Policy Forum website.
Yes, of course.
So
you can use all my presentation. You can find it in my website, shaularieli.com. And of course, Eli has it, this presentation, okay. And you can give it for everyone.
So we will make it available on our website, or you can go to shaularieli.com. Okay, we have a number of questions having to do with U.S. politics and the Trump plan. So I'm going to try to, they're sort of different variations on the same question. Jonathan Campbell, how do you think a, so I'll ask like three different questions or different variations. Jonathan Campbell wants to know, how do you think a democratic administration will handle future Israeli-Palestinian relations following the transformation the Trump administration has had on the Palestinians, particularly the PA? So that's one question. Johnny Jacoby wants to know, if Biden is elected, what are his options for moving things back towards two states? What should the character of his intervention be? As a broker, or propose an alternative to the Trump plan, or something else? And let me see, we had one more. Okay, well, I mean, basically people want to know, what does this do in terms of, does the Trump plan, if there's a Democratic president, inshallah, can we move back to where we were before the Trump plan was proposed, or does it move the goalpost? Does it change the situation for whoever might succeed Trump in the White House?
First of all, as you know, I can speak on behalf of the Democratic Party, but it's not only about the American administration, it's also about the Israeli government. And it's very important what we can see in the coming few days in the Israeli government. And I don't believe that there will be change. Maybe white and blue, Kahol Lavan, heads by Benny Gantz, we can put a veto on annexation idea. But as we know, even Benny Gantz is supporting the idea of annexation of the Jordan Valley. But for this, we have to wait. About the American administration, I believe that we can return to the end point of Annapolis process, but not with Bibi Netanyahu as the Israeli prime minister, with different prime minister. But the American administration, I mean, I believe the, I'm talking about this option of the Democratic Party can put a pressure on Israel not to annex even one single acre from the West Bank until we resume the negotiation according to the four parameters that I already mentioned. It's not easy to deal with this conflict when the sides are so far in their position about how to solve this issue.
Shaul, we have a number of similar questions about Palestinian reaction to any form of annexation, and also not just Palestinian. Stephen Windmuller wants to know, what are the likely reactions within the Arab world to any annexation moves by Israel? And similarly, Sanford Weiner asks, if Israel moves ahead with some form of annexation, oops, I just lost you, Sanford, where'd you go? Well, he wants to know, what would you think would be the reaction among the Palestinians? Could it end security cooperation between the PA and Israel, et cetera, et cetera?
Yes, I think that I already answered to this question, because for the Palestinians, according to the statement that came out from Mahmoud Abbas and other Palestinian leaders, it will be the end of Oslo agreement, because there is no even one Palestinian that can absorb such a unilateral step by Israel. I'm talking about the annexation, because the idea of Oslo agreement, the idea of the recognition of 242 United Nations Security Council resolution, was this is the way to fulfill the Palestinian right for establishing a Palestinian state on 22% of the historical Palestine. So by annexing part of this area means that Israel is not going to give this a right for the Palestinian. So for them, there is no deal anymore. It means this will be the end of the Oslo process, the end of the security cooperation, the end of the custom envelope, the end of all the things that we can see today between Israel and the Palestinian Authority. And I'm afraid that they will take the decision to return to the struggle, the armed struggle against Israel, and we can face the third or the fourth intifada in different means against Israel. This is something that we don't need to face in the coming future.
By the way, to everybody on the call, and Shaul, if it's okay with you, we'll go a few minutes longer than 3 o'clock East Coast time, which is 10 o'clock in Israel, because we have so many questions. So with your indulgence, Shaul, we'll go a little bit past 3 o'clock New York time. Let's see here. Why, somebody wants to know, why is there not stronger Likud opposition to the annexation plan, given the clear downsides for Israel? Not all Likud supporters are settler supporters.
First of all, the center of the Likud passed this resolution in December 2017 to annex all the Israeli settlements blocked to Israel. So this is the official policy of the movement of the Likud. The problem is that the Likud party, the members of the Likud party, I mean the center of this party, really believe that they can manage this process of annexation. They really believe that they can annex only Area C with less than 100,000 Palestinians. They are ready even to give them the Israeli citizenship or at least the Israeli residency, but they don't understand that is the first step in this domino process. It will begin in annexing part of Area C, but in the end of this process, because of the response of the Palestinian Authority and the response of the PLO, the end of this process will be annexing of Area A and B, or at least to resume the or to renew the military administration and the civil administration, the Israeli civil administration in this area. So we know that the Israeli government, and of course not the Likud party, never made any deep research about the implications of such a unilateral step. This is the first time after Trump vision came out there that the prime minister nominate a special committee with the name the sovereignty committee to find the way how to apply the Israeli law on the Israeli settlements in the Jordan Valley in the West Bank.
Thanks, Shaul. Abner Goldstein says that Michael talked about the current political impasse. Do you have a view on the likely outcome and what would be its impact on any peace possibilities?
Really, I don't know, because first of all, it's not my arena, but the political system in Israel. But I can tell you that Benny Gantz together with Bibi Netanyahu and other partners like Amir Peretz, it means that we kept the same situation regarding to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. I mean, we will not annex, I hope so, that we will not annex any part of the West Bank, but we will not resume the negotiation with the Palestinians. So it will be the status quo, which means it will be a creeping annexation of the West Bank.
Peter Lintel asked another question on annexation, which has to do with the EU. In your opinion, can there be a role for the EU? And if so, what steps should the EU adopt in order to prevent annexation?
You know, as I said before, I believe that only the Americans have the leverage on Israel, but still the EU has the power, you know, to do something with the economic issue. But we know that unilateral annexation is a red line for the EU, but we don't know what kind of sanction they want to put on Israel. but I prefer to see the EU has the courage to put a new plan to resume the negotiation between Israel and the PLO. I'm talking about carrot and not only about the sticks. So the way to do it is to condemn the idea of annexation, but parallelly to put a new plan according to the international community resolution, according to the former negotiation between the Israel and the PLO in front of both sides. For this, they have to coordinate this step, of course, with the American administration, and I'm not sure that the Trump administration is ready for such an initiative from the EU.
Shaul Arieli says, excellent presentation. What is your understanding of the scope of settlement annexation that the Joint Israeli-American Committee is currently considering? Do the Trump plan maps indicate it? Is it only, quote unquote, the built up areas within settlements or more than that footprint?
We don't know because it was conceptual map. I tried to translate this conceptual map to so many detailed map that I presented in this presentation. But I believe that when they say the Israeli settlements, they mean at least the build-up area and the area between the barrier and the settlements. It means it's a huge area inside the Palestinian state. Even we are talking only about 16,000 Israelis, which is a so small number to deal with, because Israel has the ability to evacuate 16 or 17 small settlements. But is it a principle? And this is the first step, to have these effects on the ground and to harm the Palestinian contiguity and to harm the Palestinian fabric of life.
We have a number of questions, Shaul, about the reaction of the Arab world to annexation, to what's in the Trump plan. Could you speak a little bit about that, and particularly the impact of the Trump plan on Jordan, both its release and its potential implementation?
Yes, we know what was the Arab League response to this vision, because they stick to their peace initiative that took place in 2002. And since then they approve it every year, because for them, this is the easiest way to demonstrate their support in the Palestinian issue. They don't want to deal with the with their public. I mean, the Arab public in each country refused to accept such a plan, which means that this is against the Arab interest. It's against the Palestinian interest and the vision. So I believe that King Abdullah II is very afraid from the implications of a unilateral step that will taken by Israel, because he need to control the more than 50% of his population that will respond to such a step that will taken by Israel. So it's something against the stability of the area. It's something that can harm the peace process the peace treaty between Israel and Jordan, the military coordination and cooperation that we have with them. And also the same apply with the Egyptian.
A related question about Jordan comes from George Bulow. He wants to know, what prospects are there for the continuation of a non-Palestinian controlled Jordan, irrespective of which American policy remains or which Israeli faction ultimately controls the country?
So it means, you know, according to this vision, the Palestinians are not control their borders. They don't have external borders, not with Egypt and not with Jordan. There is a special, there will be a designated roads for the Palestinian traffic to cross this area controlling by Israel in the Jordan Valley to reach to Jordan and back. I would like to say that Israel doesn't need the Jordan Valley for its security itself, because we have very detailed security arrangements with the Jordanian, because we have our strategic depth according to this peace treaty that was signed in 1994 with Jordan, because the Jordanian are not allowed to sign a military alliance with hostile organization or countries to Israel. They are not allowed to let them to cross or to park in their state. So it means that Israel, the real security border of Israel, it's not the Jordan River, it's the border between Iraq and Jordan, means more than 300 kilometers far from the center of the state of Israel. And we need to keep this, and we don't need the Jordan Valley, because the Jordan Valley is even killing area. So we don't need it. If we have the peace treaty with Jordan, and the same paragraph we already agreed with the Palestinian to have it as a part of the peace treaty with them.
We've got one or two more questions, Shaul, and then we'll wrap it up. Julie Tagan asks, what does the Israeli public think about annexation? Can you talk about current attitudes?
According to so many polls, most of the Israeli, I mean, even the Jewish society, against the idea of annexation. I think it's about 60% of the Israeli public against this idea. But what surprised me is the fact, according to so many polls, that if the Israeli government decide to annex the West Bank, the Israelis, almost 78% of them prefer to keep the Palestinians without any rights, even not residents of Israel, even we annex this area. It means the Israeli society prefer to be apartheid state and not to give the rights to the Palestinians, even if we annexing the West Bank. And this is very, very severe position. I mean, it surprised me to see it.
That's very disturbing. Yes. Final question comes from me, Shaul. As we understand it, the negotiations between Gantz and Netanyahu broke down in part, well, it was partly about some of the ministries, some of the positions that Gantz wanted for Kohol Levan, but annexation was somewhere in the mix. What is your understanding about how far Gantz was willing to go towards annexation in a unity government with Netanyahu?
Really, I don't know, but I want to believe that Gantz knows the implications of such unilateral step. And I would like to believe that he will block any idea and prevent any idea of annexation, even of the Jordan Valley, despite the fact that he came out before the election that he's ready for annexation of the Jordan Valley, but he added it must be with the coordination with the Americans administrations and with the international community. So we don't know what Israeli means, because we know that the American administration or Trump administration is support this idea. And we want to believe that this a condition of the international community support, this will be the tool for Gantz to prevent this annexation by Israel.
So we have more than exceeded our time, and we could have gone on longer, which means, Shaul, you obviously have to come back and do this again. And I think there'd be great interest in having you again on a webinar. Really, toda rabba, Shaul, for your presentation and for your information and for your work with us and for the work you do in general. And I also want to thank everybody on the call for taking the time to join us today. Again, as a reminder, we're having these briefings every Tuesday at 2 p.m. Eastern, 11 a.m. Pacific time. Our next program on Tuesday, April 21st, will feature Israel Policy Forum's Dr. Shira Efron and Evan Gottesman discussing our new study, In Search of a Viable Option. You can find links to our upcoming programs on our Israel Policy Hub website at ipf.li/hub. Finally, if you find our webinars and our digital content and resources useful, please consider supporting our work. If you already support Israel Policy Forum, we greatly appreciate it. Thank you all once again for joining us. Be well and Chag Sameach.